Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. By my reckoning, this is episode 198. I am very excited to have this guest on, seeing as I've already spoke to his Legends Never Die tag team partner. It's the Chaotic Lucha himself. It's Sami Sparx. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Thank you very much for having me.
So I don't like to hide behind the curtain for people, but this episode has been a interesting day trying to get it recorded. Between myself being in A&E overnight and then trying to organize this recording, and then you've got tech issues, and we'll not more likely I'll have tech issues probably at some point in this hour.
Welcome to the laggiest episode of the world.
Yeah, so hopefully if you're listening to this, it's worked, and if you look down and see it's only a 10-minute episode, it didn't work as well as we hoped.
It will be the best 10-minute episode you will have ever listened to.
That's the one. That's it. That's exactly it. So we'll start with the normal question, most basic of podcasting questions in wrestling. What got you into wrestling? So what was the moment on TV or whatever? What got you hooked on wrestling?
Okay, so I'd say my earliest memory that I have is I can remember my mother was very much into wrestling, like she still is, and it was, so wrestling was kind of just always on and around for me. She was the reason why I got into wrestling, and the earliest memory that I have is Eddie Guerrero versus Rey for the custody of Dominic, and that is my earliest memory. I can remember the adverts for it, and I can remember some of the match. I've not watched it in a long time, but that is like my youngest memory.
2005, then.
That's... Yeah, I will have been about 4 or 5, depending on the month.
I speak to so many young wrestlers now; it just makes me feel old and older. So, yeah, so 2005, then 4 or 5. Okay, so very weird time then. So you started watching, you saw Dominic for the first time, and now he's probably one of the most heralded bad guys in WWE.
Right now. I love it. I love everything that Dominic is doing. I think like that's the one reason why I would tune into SmackDown or Raw if he's on it. I will say though, and I'm gonna throw it out here, Dominic should have gone over at WrestleMania. I did not see the need for Ray to not put him over. I understand it's a WWE decision, but it was the wrong one for me.
You know what? I think we're gonna. I'm hoping we get like some sort of ladder match at SummerSlam and just kind of make it all full circle thing. That's where we got Dominic introduced, and then we'll see. I don't know if it's going to be like hair versus mask. I don't know how that would work in a ladder match, but we'll find a way.
There's just a mask up there that Dominic has to grab. There's a razor up there that Ray has to grab.
That's what I was thinking. Speaking of, we'll do a big read later, but you have like a manscaped trimmer up there, you know.
Get the sponsors at the side of the ring again, like they did Mania.
That was the weirdest thing. Like, I didn't really, because it was like, what, 3 o'clock in the morning by the time that match happened, so I wasn't totally awake for it, but then I didn't even hear there was a sponsor, and then suddenly there was a big Cinnamon Toast Crunch mascot at ringside. I was like, what happened here?
I think my favorite part was the commentators being like, this rivalry is father versus son, the biggest feud out of all of them. And then there's just that guy dancing in the corner, dressed up in a costume. I'm like, you can't take it seriously after seeing that. You just can't.
I like some of their sponsor stuff, though. The Blackout Mountain Dew thing, I didn't really care about the match anyway in the first place, so that wasn't really helping. But yeah, I loved the zombie one.
I'm a big Bray Wyatt fan, and even that match I was like, do you know what I mean? Like, it was very... I think they tried to go for something cool, and it just didn't play out. But I will say, that whole rivalry made me love LA Knight, because I've never seen LA Knight before. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I immediately fell in love with LA Knight.
I think it's one of those things where... We'll speak about your career in a bit. But it was one of those things where when Bray Wyatt came back, it was like, leave the memories alone. It's like, you realize going, yeah, we should have just left him. Because I think now he's come back, it's like everyone's realizing, it's a bit too weird.
I think it was reported that he walked out or he had an injury and stuff like that, so it's very weird. I think if he does come back, they just need to bring the whole Fiend gimmick back with him, but not put him against Seth Rollins in a Hell in a Cell match for a disqualification to happen.
Take away his big hammer.
Yeah.
So 2005. There we go. 2005 is your first memories then. So
back on tracks, So that's my first actual memory of wrestling. And then when I was six, I can remember going to a live event in Manchester. And the thing that actually fully got me into wrestling, being like, I want to do this. I was 6 years old. We went to Manchester's, the WWE live event. And after the cameras went off, Batista grabbed a bunch of kids and brought them into the ring to celebrate. And I was one of the kids that he picked up and took into the ring while I was wearing a Rey Mysterio t-shirt. And I literally danced in the ring, got put back over the barricade. And first thing I said to my mother is, I'm never washing this t-shirt. And I kid you not, I refused to wash it until my mum did it behind my back. And I was very upset.
That's amazing. So we can say WWE's own Sami Sparx on the podcast. So you're in a WWE ring in the MEN arena. I'm assuming it's MEN.
That's like my earliest memory of like going, I want to do this, was when I was like stood in that ring being like, this would be really cool.
That's amazing. I remember like Batista, I saw Batista show up in Aberdeen. He did obviously WWE. He wasn't doing indies. So he didn't, and he was just, I was second row, 2008, I think it was, 2007, 2008. And I dyed my hair blue. I don't know if that explains why I don't have any anymore. And he just stared at me and started doing like a four eyes kind of sign and pointed at me. And I was like, is he calling me four eyes or is he just pointing at me because I've got glasses and I've got blue hair? I don't know what's happening. I'm enjoying it, but I don't know what's happening.
So what I'm hearing is we've got Rey Mysterio who tells 8-year-olds to grow up and do something with their lives. And you've got Batista calling people four eyes. What a tag team.
That was the same show that Dave Taylor told him he was going to slap me because I was booing him because he's English.
Why not?
You know, and Chuck Palumbo. He was against Chuck Palumbo. God, what a time. Right. Anyway, so that point then. So you saw it. You got in the ring. You got your Rey Mysterio t-shirt all sweaty with Batista all over it. And it's never getting washed again. Do you still have that t-shirt?
I do. It's a bit small for me now. At the time it was very big for me. It was like I'd say it was down to like nearly my knees at the time. Like the t-shirt, and now it's a bit small for me, but I think it's in the cupboard downstairs. I've moved house like three times, and I'm always like, that is the one thing that's going with me wrestling wise, that and my gear. I need my gear.
That's actually, I didn't expect that. That's such a cool story to have. Like, you're so when you did that though, were you a fan of Batista, or was it just a case of afterwards you're like Batista could do no wrong?
Well, I knew he was there, and I was like, this guy's really cool. And then I think the reason why he actually must have picked me out was because at the time it was, what, we're talking 2006, so we're talking about the time where like they were doing the whole Rey Mysterio and Batista would like kind of pally, you know what I mean? I'm pretty sure. So I guess because I had a Rey Mysterio t-shirt, that's probably why one of the reasons why he picked me.
So, but yeah, from that point, like I say, you had maybe a bit more of a soft spot for Batista because, like, for all the discourse in the internet world, I always have a soft spot for CM Punk because he did the signing after the show. He was the only one that did the whole, all the barriers outside the AECC. And I'm like, yeah, I know he says things and I don't really like him, but he's still got a little bit there in my heart because he did that.
Do you want him to come back?
I don't care, to be honest. I liked him for doing that, but I don't care. I don't watch AEW, so
fair.
He's nothing to me, to be honest.
Yeah, that's fair.
I keep hearing CM Punk versus Goldberg as Eric Bischoff swatting for Wembley, and I'm like, hey, maybe I'd watch that.
I'd probably watch that. I think would be funny.
I wouldn't go down to Wembley to see it, but I'd certainly I would give a watch to CM Punk Goldberg. I think that would be a riot. I don't know how good it would be, but it would be a riot.
I think it'd be funny. Just spear after GTS after spear after GTS. That's all they need. Like 5 minutes of that, 10 minutes of that, and everyone's done. Like we can just sit there and be happy.
Yeah, just Punk Lesnar. Punk Lesnar. Because that went on forever. Goldberg Lesnar. Just five minutes in and out. That's all we need.
Yep.
Sami Sparx, then. your career. We keep derailing it, which is
what's
always...
a career? My career? I don't know what that is.
Well, so far, according to Cage Match, we've got a 2017 debut. So that would be, by my reckoning, about, so you'd be 17, because you're about 5 when you saw your first show. So what made you decide to go, right, that's it, I've watched it, I've been in the ring with Batista, I'm going to go do it myself?
So I kind of stopped watching wrestling around 15, 16, that bit. And then I had a friend named Kevin, and I was very close to Kevin and his mom, Stella. And they were like, oh, well, there's a local wrestling show, like that come around. They do Carlisle, they do Lockerbie, Dumfries, Annan. They do all over there. You should come watch it. And so we went to watch Target Wrestling in Lockerbie for the first time. And I bought a medallion t-shirt. And I asked Ryan Devlin, who was the announcer at the time, is medallion going to be here? Because for some reason, after seeing the first 3 matches, and we're on first, the halftime bit, we're on the break, I was like, I really wanted to see medallion because I thought the t-shirt was cool, because it was smash his dial in, and then it was like the actual like medallion that he holds, but it was gold. And I thought it was like a really cool t-shirt. So I'm asking Ryan, I'm like, is medallion going to be here? He's like, oh, I don't think so, because at this time I'm pretty sure medallion was on injury. And then all of a sudden, through the curtains at the back, went after one of the matches, he just appears, and I'm like, yeah. So that was the first time. And then we won, I think we won the raffle on that one, which gave us tickets to go see Carlisle, like the venue show, like the big show that they do. So we went to that, and then I found out that they did training, and I was like, you know what? I've loved it for years. I might as well give it a shot. So I went down with Kevin, and me and Kevin started training together. And the trainer was John Natras, and he was very, I did one-to-one session, so it was me and Kevin and just John, and the occasional person would come down and help, whether it was Carnage, Damon Havoc, who I know you're a fan of, I'm pretty sure, Damon Havoc, and so like they were just helping me for like the first like few sessions until like I was getting it, and then I got put into the main group, and I've been there ever since. But yeah, they were the people that also made me keep a part of it, because first time you bump, you go, oh, is this something I want to do? You're like, at 16, I was like, I didn't think at like the end of me going to 17, I'd be wishing like I'd never thought I'd like do this, because I'd have a bad back at 16. Do you know what I mean?
yeah, you're right. Damon Havoc, because I think it was during last summer, I was like, right, I need some wrestling to watch. It wasn't on patrol, and I just binged a bunch of Target shows from when they came back from the pandemic. And Damon Havoc, just the king of short style, just something I just really enjoyed watching about his wrestling. And yourself as well, we'll speak about a match that I really went, oh, this Sami Sparx guy is pretty good as well, which is, I think it was the tag match. I think it was yourself and Soldato against Asylum and Tim Strange. I think it was the Falls Count Anywhere or No Holds Barred, yeah, or something like that. Yeah. And you lived up to the moniker, the Chaotic Lucha, during that match. I was like, oh, wow, okay, right, I'm enjoying this. But yeah, we'll get into that in a little bit more later. So 16, 17, you started. I'm noticing there's kind of a pattern here. Rey Mysterio being one of your first matches that you watched, and Medallion being one of the first like local wrestlers that you've really enjoyed seeing and being excited to see, both wearing masks. So is masks wrestlers just always something that you've enjoyed seeing and just enjoy masks in general?
I mean, yeah, I'll be very honest, when I first started, there was like I never pictured myself in a mask, if that makes sense. Like, it wasn't like, I'm definitely going to wear a mask, this is what my character is going to be, because I never, like, I'd make a character on, like, the WWE games. It was always, I'd always go with the same name, and I'd never wear a mask on it. Like, I'd usually be the guy wearing biker shorts, no knee pads, really long boots, kind of like CM Punk style kick pads.
Mm-hmm.
That was, like, always my thing, and the name was Loki Sparx, and that was the plan. Like, the original name that I was going to go with when I first started wrestling was Loki Sparx, but I ended up going with Sammy because my middle name is actually Samuel.
Yeah.
So that's where that came from. But yeah, I never really saw myself in a mask until it was my trainer John who went, "How do you feel about a mask?" And I loved it because I was always the shy one who was like terrified. So he was like, "Well, here's a mask. Have fun. Go find a mask. Send me a couple of pictures of what you're thinking, and yeah, get it, and we'll go from there." And I got my mask, and I had really long hair at the time. So my first match was a Rumble match in Lockerbie, the place that I first watched it. I got to like debut there, so I thought that was really cool. What I didn't know is when you have long hair that you need to tie it up, otherwise it does this. So I could see. So during the match, Medallion throws me into a guy, but he goes, "Spear him." So I'm just running like this, like, have I done it?
So, when it came to masks, though, because, of course, I've spoken to quite a few mask guys in the past, Talon Jr., Lucha DS, Soldato as well, and a lot of them, thing I'm most intrigued by is, first time I've done this an episode, and I apologize because just my own chaos. Usually if I've got a mask wrestler on, I'll open the episode wearing a mask. But I've learned that they're so hot to wear. So when did you seek out any advice from like sort of a Medallion who wears a full face mask, including the eyes? Did you seek out any advice for what to get?
I was kind of just told, send me photos of what you're looking at, and then when you make a decision that you're fully happy with, get it, and we'll go and like we'll just use that mask. I never really thought, like, when I was getting a mask, I never really thought that it would be any different of just wrestling without a mask. And then you do that first mask, that first match with the mask on, you're dying immediately. Like, heat is not your friend. And I'm asthmatic, so usually if I know I'm going to be in a long match, I'm like, right, I am putting an inhaler underneath the ring. That's like my one thing. I'm always like if I know I'm going to have like a long match or I'm going to be absolutely gassed, I'm like, right, inhaler goes under the ring, so when I can like just slide off the ring, I can very quickly put my head under the ring, take a puff and go, right, let's go.
That's genuinely a very clever move, because the last thing you want to do is be in a mask and having a panic attack or asthma attack.
I think that's also what Batista did, like when he was wrestling. I think he also, like in a podcast, I can't remember which one, I think he also said, I think it was Batista, I might be wrong here, and if I am, I'm going to get slated. Please don't. But I think it was Batista who said that he has like really bad asthma, and so he would have to put an inhaler under the ring, which is where I got the idea from. I was like, that's a really good idea. So that's why I started doing it, just in case.
So just for everyone else, because it ruins the magic otherwise, I'm just going to put a mask on my hand for a second. There we go.
Yes! There we go.
Unfortunately, I can't wear wrestling masks for any length of time because I refuse to wear contact lenses. And I'm not wearing a mask otherwise because I can't see. So put that away. I have a box next to me with all my kind of wrestling trinkets and tickets and all that kind of stuff. It's not like I just have this readily to hand. So not like I just go, right, I'll put the mask on. Here we go. I put that into a dirty mind. Right, let's move on. So you got your debut then. Like I said, long hair, can't see. But with the mask and everything, did you find that you just tapped into the character straight away? Was that just you were able to relax and just be Sami Sparx, or was there still some fear?
I mean, the whole character was just a guy in a mask. That's what it first started at. And then, for the most part, I was fighting Target talent. Like, I wasn't facing outsiders that weren't a part of Target at this point. And so, again, it was just a guy in a mask who was doing flippy stuff. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then it kind of then turned into the chaotic lucha, but that was very like, again, I went from 2016/17 all the way up to like, I'd say just before COVID, as a guy in a mask, but who could do really cool flip stuff when he wanted to. And like that literally was just the gimmick. The gimmick was just the mask. Mm-hmm. And then COVID hit, and I've never, I don't know the saying, but it's like, you don't realise you miss something so much until it's taken away from you. That was my situation. I was, like, I realised how much wrestling, like, doing it meant to me. So I really put a lot of time, I was like, the minute I get back, I'm going to put a lot of time into it. I'm going to put a lot of thought into it. And I'm gonna do better.
So it was like one of those things where for that first little bit, I don't know if this is the right kind of way to put it, but you're kind of playing wrestler for that first little bit because you didn't really have anything to sink your teeth into, and you were just a guy on the roster. But yeah, COVID hit, and you're like, no, I want to be an integral part of a promotion, this promotion target or whatever. I want to actually have a character instead.
I wanted to be a wrestler. I wanted to be one of these guys who are traveling the country. Like, that's what I wanted to be, like, and that's, so I was like, I can't just be a guy in a mask, because if someone asked me what your character is, all I would have been able to say is, oh, I'm a guy in a mask, and they'll go, that's not a gimmick, that's an attire. So I was like, so I put some thought into it, and I was like, well, I enjoy doing the stupid, like, flips where I'm throwing myself at each other, throwing myself at people. I was like, so let's use that. And I think it was Saul that I was talking to, and he was like, this is when we were tagging, and he was like, we need a tag name. So we came up with the High Flying, Death Defying, Chaotic Luchas. And I was like, I really like that. And then it kind of was like, when I wasn't tagging with Saul and I was still on a show, it was like, well, that's what our tag name is. What if I can take some of it and turn it into my own? Mm-hmm. Which is where the chaotic lucha came from. So if it wasn't for tagging with Saul, Chaotic Lucha, like, having that nickname never would have been a thing. Do you know what I mean? Which I think is really cool. I will say tagging with Saul helped me improve so much. Like, I learned so much from Saul, match planning, positioning, everything like that came from, like, working with Saul. So
it also set you apart from other masked wrestlers, of course, because we've got Lucha DS, of course, is probably the most well known in Scotland at the moment. Anyway, he's everywhere, just about, like, literally everywhere. I think he has got a free weekend now until 10th of June. Or something like that.
It's absolutely crazy, and it's so nice to see how well he's doing, though. Do you know what I mean? Like,
absolutely. We've got that. We've got Talon Jr., of course, out of FPWA, who's just outstanding. We've got, of course, Soldato as well, GPWA, as well, and then Robbie Wishart. Solar. Robbie Solar is.
What have you done? yeah.
So Lucha Scotland is in Falcon whenever he appears.
Whenever. Yeah, now I'm part of that group, which is really weird.
so we don't have that many masked wrestlers in the country. So unless you want to count things like there's a boy up in Aberdeen at the moment called Mr. WrestleZone, and we've got Sistos as well and all that kind of stuff. So we've got, like, masked wrestlers, but we don't have, like, traveling masked wrestlers outside of your Lucha DS and what have you. So. With you guys that you kind of, before Lucha Scotland became a thing, before you were a part of Lucha Scotland, I should say, again, with these guys that you would maybe try and pick some tips for wrestling with the masks. I think Lucha's done Target as well, Soldato.
I think, so, I never, it's really bad. I didn't really watch that much wrestling, like, once I, like, started wrestling. Like, I mean, like, indie stuff or WWE, I kind of, like, or, like, old school WWE. And I was constantly told, this is what you need to look at to improve. And me, who doesn't like sitting down for more than, like, an hour watching something because I get bored, I was like, no. But then I met Saul. At Target. And this was years ago. I can't remember the year. But I think... I can't remember where it was. I'm sorry. I'm trying to think. Okay. But I met him, and he was, like, a really nice guy. And I watched the match. And, like, they had a match. Saul had a match, and I was watching it from the side. And I was like, this guy's really good. like, this is what I need to look at. So he was the main reason why I actually did a bit of research. Didn't do a lot because, again, I didn't like sitting down for more than an hour watching wrestling at that point. But, no, he was one of the reasons why I also started watching a bit more wrestling.
The pleather shorts. So you mentioned that, of course, that was kind of your character that you would have in your games when you were Loki Sparx. You'd have the long shorts, the biker shorts, and what have you. You don't see pleather much nowadays. So again, was there a choice between like the design, or was that just?
I loved the design of them. I thought the design in them was amazing, and also it went with the mask.
Of course, yeah, the red, black, and white.
And I fell in love with them. And then, so I fell in love with that gear. And then I can't remember again what year, but I was told, come on, man, like, you need to update your gear. Because I started with them ones, and then I reordered them, but with my name on the backside. So, actually, the old ones are right in front of me, actually, like, the ones that don't have my name on. But, so, yeah, I ended up getting the same ones with my name on the backside. And I thought that was really cool because that was also, like, my first, other than my T-shirt with, like, my mask and that said Sami Sparx, that was my first actual piece of gear that I ever customized. Because, like, they're from, like, you could get them, you can't anymore, but you could get them on a Lucha. So they were just generic. Anyone could buy it. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that I was able to, I even got to customize just by putting my name on the backside was incredible to me. Do you know what I mean? It was like, I'm doing it. So yeah, I fell in love with that kind of gear, and I kept telling people, you should try tights. And I was like, no, I really like my gear. And I eventually, once I started tagging with Adam, I eventually gave in and we got tights. And sorry, Fulton.
Fine. He's got Adam on his Twitter, so
I finally gave in and I wore them, and this was before I put LND on them, so I wore them in a singles match, and I went backstage and I went to Fulton and I went, right, shut up, you were right, you earned about another thing yet again, because usually how our conversations go is I have one opinion, Fulton has another, which is mainly the right one, I refuse to believe it's right, and then he proves me wrong every time. There's been a couple of times where he wasn't right, but most of the time he is right.
I don't know if his questions will bring up any of those instances, because we've got quite a few through Instagram, so we'll get to them in a
minute. I'm really looking forward to the questions.
Some of them I have opinions on straight away, because some ones like Ruby Roberts and what have you, so there's things that I want to know from them. Before I do that, we'll talk about your title win, and then okay, let's talk about Legends Never Die. I'll do the ad, and then we'll get into the questions. And that seems to be it. Your title win. Tag team titles in April 2022. You and Sadato defeated Asylum and Tim Strange to win. It was Asylum and Tim Strange, wasn't it? That you defeated.
I lost them to the Lawless, but I won them in the triple threat tag title match, which was Havoc and Roy Story, Tribal and Jimmy T.
I've watched that match. I should really remember. So it was like winning the title then. I don't know if you're a title guy, you're a belt guy, or you just, it was just a cool little thing to have. But as someone who would have been wrestling at that point, what, 4 years, something like 3-4 years, to win a title must be pretty epic.
So the way it went is we didn't know we were winning. We had no idea. We didn't even know it was for the belts, which was insane to me, looking back. But we planned the match, and we planned it with us going over, and we knew that the titles were, I'm pretty sure, vacated or getting vacated, but we didn't know it was for the belts. And we planned the match. We were about to go out, and then Ryan Devlin, the announcer, said it's for the belts. And I immediately looked at John, who is the booker and the trainer, and he just had a smile on his face. And I'm like, this isn't happening. And I immediately went over and I went, thank you, before I'd even gone out, and like that music's just about to play. And then I locked up with Havoc. We got in the ring, bell rings, and I locked up with Havoc, and I went, "Are we still going over?" And he laughed and he went, "Yes." And I was like, "Are you sure this is like what's meant to happen?" So we won the belts, which was such a surprise to me. And I got back, and the first thing I did was Sol pinned Havoc. And the first thing that I did was went up to, and you can see it in the video actually, if you go and watch the match, you can see me crawling to the ring. And while Havoc's there selling, I go, "Thank you." And then I hug Sol. And I got backstage, and the first thing I did was I hugged Havoc. Because Havoc knew we were going over the all day and didn't say anything. And like was trying to get us to have like all our stuff in the match. And so I got back and I hugged him. I went, "Thank you so much." I hugged Sol and I ended up crying because like a lot of people say a title is just a prop. For me, it's different. For me, that is the booker and the owner of a company trusting you with one of like the quote unquote what is known as one of the biggest prizes in a wrestling company.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, it meant a lot that the promoter trusted me with that. So yeah, I ended up crying for a minute. Like I'm there, like crying on Havoc's shoulder, be like, "Thank you so much." And he's like, "Pull it together." I'm like, "Okay."
But I like that kind of story because, like you say, some folks just see it as, "Oh, it's nerdy at the office. I've got a belt. Cool." But to have pride in it, like you say, you're getting trusted with a position on the card where you're going to be a champion. So you have to step up and put on championship caliber matches. So it's a big thing. And plus, I just love holding belts. I think belts are cool just to hold in general and to get your own. I don't know if Target's one of those companies that lets you take it home, or if they just keep it and you get it when you're at the show. But
I wanted to, but I was told no.
I don't know if that's more of a case of they saw your reaction to winning it, going, "No, I can't trust this guy. I don't know what he's
oh doing." Yeah, if they let me take this belt home, it would have been on that back wall, never to be seen in Target again.
We'd have went in the fridge first, of course, and because you know that's the CM Punk thing, and then afterwards, yeah, it would just be everywhere. You'd go out to do shopping. Oh, I'll put the belt on.
Why not?
part of my, I've remembered everything. I've got my wallet. I've got my keys. I've got my belt.
Let's go.
But yeah, so it's a really nice looking belt. So it's very tempting to be that guy and do that.
I will say, so Sol did get to take his home, which I was very jealous of. But Sol came back the next month and he had shined his. And I was like, "That's not fair. I didn't know you were going to do this. You didn't tell me you were going to." And I kid you not, it was the most shiniest thing I've seen. And I was like, "I want it. Swap belts with me." He was like, "No." It was like, I put in 25 minutes of cleaning this belt. I was like, "No, swap with me. I'm Target's own. I deserve to hold that one." He was like, "You're not having it." So every single time we won after going out there, every single time I was like, "Pass me your belt. Let me hold yours. Let me hold the shiny one for the photos." And he's like, "No." So I never got to hold the shiny one.
I love hearing about Target Team Wrestling just being possessive about like belts generally, like one shiny, one's not, but they're generally, they look the same. Because I think it might have been Looking Sharp and Krieger, but I think it was Kings of Catch. They had the ICW belts, and one of them was more particular about having one or the other, because one did have the, of course, the thing over the top, and one had the like the lines at the bottom. And I was like, no, I'm having the one with the lines at the top. That's my one. It's the prettier one. And I was like, it's just a weird thing. But,
just the fact that he shined it up, and he didn't tell me. He could have given me a one. I would have been more than happy to grab the belt and shine it up. But no, turns up with it looking like the cleanest thing. Like, do you know the SpongeBob meme where, like, the guy's bald and, like, shiny, and everyone's going, and he's going, "Bald, my eyes." That was me with that belt, with how shiny it was. I was like, "That is so rude." I was like, could have given me a heads up.
Get the Brasso.
Aye.
So of course then moved on, you had your, I mean, you're still affiliated with Lucha Scotland, of course, but yeah, ended up getting a little tag team with Fulton King, with it being, oh, actually, one thing, the last thing about the belt, it's actually, oh, I would say it's okay you have the kind of dirtier looking belt at the time because you were chaotic. You're not supposed, you're not playing by the rules. You're not staying at home trying the belts. You're going out and just like jumping off stuff and things. So it works. It's fine. I'll justify it for you. It's okay. So legends never die. So we've got Fulton King and yourself. Chris, you spoke about the joining of your tandem. I've forgotten his answer, but people go back and check the Fulton King podcast that I did with them. But what was your side of it? How did Legends Never Die begin?
So I am really good friends with Fulton. I enjoyed everything he was doing in the spawn of Target. I thought, like if you go back and you watch his matches, he doesn't shut up. Like, he's constantly at that crowd, and I thought that was really good. I thought that was really cool. So I ended up becoming... it was my birthday, and I invited him to come out for a couple of drinks. And that was, like, the first time I'd actually invited him, and I got to know him a bit better, and I thought he was a really cool guy. And then we ended up hanging out more, and he became, like, my best friend. And then we saw that Liu King Sharp was starting a dojo, and I was like, you want to come? I'm gonna go. It's like, it's only £5 a session, which is really good and really cheap, and I was like, I want to give it a shot. And he was like, okay, I'll give it a shot. And so we went up there, and we thought it was amazing, so we kept going regularly. And then Buffer came over, and a week before Buffer, I'd said, we got put as a tag team, we're just doing training matches. And our chemistry was really good. I really enjoyed the match. I just thought it worked. And we were in the car and we were joking and we went, hey, want to become a tag team? And he goes, aye, why not? And then we took the idea to Liu King Sharp and he went, okay, We'll make it work. And Buffer was there, and he goes, okay, you two, tag match. Think of a tag move. Think of tag moves. Put one tag move in this match, in this training match. I'm like, okay. So we threw a tag move in there, and then we finished the match, and Buffer had said that he thought we got put together in that match because we had been together as a tag team for years. And Liu King Sharp said to him, no, these guys haven't been tagging that long, maybe 2-3 weeks. They've been training. And he literally went, these guys need to be a thing. And from that point, we just took off with it. We were idea after idea after idea. Like, we spent... So Fulton lived in Carlisle at the time, which from Glasgow, it's about, I want to say, maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours. So we were like... We had like an hour and a half, 2 hour drive in the car of just thinking of ideas. Mm. And like, we were thinking of different names for the tag team, and we were trying to find stuff that he liked and that I liked. And then we found Legends Never Die from, I want to say it's an album. No, I think it's a band that he likes. And it's the band that he likes, I believe, is Heroes Get Remembered, Legends Never Die. And mine was because of an album from an artist by Juice WRLD who I really liked. And so we agreed on Legends Never Die. And we just ran from there. Like, we were thinking of different moves, stuff like that. We then, again, just on the way home, thought of like tag moves, names for tag moves, which is where we got our first finisher, Midnight Breakdown. Like, we just... And it, like, and once the ball started rolling, there was no stopping it. Like, we were just idea after idea after idea. And I've got to be honest, he also made, for all he's not been in this business as long as I have, he's made me love even more of it. He's pushed me even more than I, like, than anyone else has. So yeah, I've got him to thank for making me love this business even more than I already did, honestly. Well,
one of those things where he's just unleashed your creativity even more because he's coming up with so much stuff.
Yeah. And like, I've loved every minute of it. I will say I've come to love tag team wrestling more than I have singles, and that's because of Legends Never Die. that's because of the time that we've put in. Because with Saul, I didn't get to speak to him as much. And yeah, I learned so much from him, and I thought the chemistry was good. But I'd say my chemistry with Legends Never, as Legends Never Die with Fulton, is unmatched. Like, and like I said, once that ball started rolling, we weren't stopping it. And it's just idea after idea. Creative, like, creative wise, he's constantly looking at new stuff that we can do. Like, he was, I was getting messages the other night where I got a paragraph and I was like, why didn't you just call me? I didn't think of that. I was like, what? So yeah, we talk all the time about different ideas and then we give it a try. And if it works, we keep it. If not, we'll try and alter it and make it our own even more.
Well, speaking of balls rolling, here's the ad. Support for SWN is brought to you by Manscaped, who's the best in men's below-the-waist grooming. There you go, segues. Their products are precision-engineered tools for your family jewels. Manscaped's Performance Package, the ultimate men's hygiene bundle. This is like the most professional one I've done so far. Join 8 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped with this exclusive offer for you, which is weird because the next one is the first one I've done with Scotty, and it was an absolute disaster. 20% off of free worldwide shipping with the code SWN20 at manscaped.com. It says here, if my math's correct, that's about 16 million balls being looked after. So you get a nice, I've got the kit. I'll tell you all about it next week, because I'll in the next episode of Scotty Swift, because I had the kit at the time. I don't have it. I do have it in front of me, but we're not going to go through it. We don't have a lot of time to.
Come on, we need this. We need the.
So it's very nice. Very, very nice for the balls. There we go. Right. There we go. That's the ad. Nice and quick. Let's go into the questions then.
That was the best ad I've ever seen.
Thank you. It's again, this is the third time I've recorded it, because I did one with Ian Skinner as well, and it was also a disaster. So this is the third time lucky, first time people are hearing it. So let's just start with that one. Right. Loads of questions. We've got also a really quick fire name association that we'll go through. Matthew has provided.
I'm just going to say what I think of these people, and then we'll just power through it.
Yeah, that's fine. Judas Gray, hope you know Judas Gray when I ask the question. And God, I hope it's not a scary answer. DMG.
No, immediately. Good. No, I do not want to join it. I have no intention of joining it. Stay away.
Thank you. I never want to explain that again. Judas Gray also asked, why are you so English?
I don't know. I'm sorry. I can't give you a decent answer on that one. I don't know. Why are you not so English? There you go. I'll answer it with a question. Why are you not so English?
You just actually watch this just so he hears himself getting put over. Yeah. he will provide an answer. Masks on, socks off, or socks on, mask off?
One more time, sorry.
Mask on, socks off, or socks on, mask off?
Mask on, socks off. This mask never comes off.
It'll mold to your face in the end. Yep. What's it like being his number one fan?
I mean, someone has to be his fan. So I guess if I'm his only fan, I have to be the number one fan. So,
you know, that was the question. That was the answer in my head going, someone has to be a fan of his, I suppose. Yep. But you're officially his only fan.
Yeah.
Will your mum join the Mincati again?
See, I'm going to have to explain that now, because that just sounds weird, doesn't it? I will say, so again, going back to it, I'll just jump over it very quickly. My mother was, again, she was the one that got me into wrestling, but without her, I would not be a wrestler. She does the merch for me. She drives me to the places. She drives Fulton to places. Like, if it wasn't for Amelia, there would be no Sami Sparx. So of course she's going to come on nights out with us, because she's just as part of the team as I am. Like, she's not taking bumps, but she's still doing all the other stuff behind the scenes. So you're damn right, she's coming on a night out with us. So yes, she will be in the catty again to have a really good night.
And finally, his last question is, do you feel sad that you're English? And in brackets, I would too.
I mean, a little bit. There's a little bit. Especially when I've had people go, oh, Lucha UK now. And I'm like, go away. Go away. There's no need.
I mean, I can't remember if Lucha DS had like his and hometown was like El. No, it wasn't Solar, I think. It was something that was very Mexican sounded, but not at the same time. His hometown. So, you know, it's worldwide. Lucha worldwide.
Lucha worldwide.
That's fair. I've got Gaz Williams with a question. He also asked me, and I realized I was way too old to answer. If you have a go-to alien from Ben 10, who would it be and why?
I wasn't a Ben 10 kid. So the one that I'll go with, just because it's the only one that I can remember, there was a red dude with like four arms. So I'm just going to go with that one. Gaz, if you know that one, there you go. The red one with four arms.
Chris Kendall asking, will you ever leave me and Golden Charlie alone? So that's Charlie Anderson.
I mean, I just enjoy battering you. Me and Fulton just enjoy whacking you and beating you over and over and over and over. When you finally win, maybe we'll leave you alone. Until then, the answer is no.
Ian Skinner, speaking of Ian Skinner. I hate this question so much.
I read this, by the way, and I didn't fully understand it. Just because I'm very... So
again, it's another one because of the timeline of how these episodes are going out. I had a breakdown at this question again, and the episode is coming out on May 19th because he asked me it, and it just terrifies me. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
I'm just gonna go with bacon because bacon is great.
That's fair. That's fair. I'd definitely go unlimited bacon because it's the answer I understand. And that
that's also another reason, but I didn't want to say that out loud, I'll be very honest, but there we go.
Just out of curiosity, but when you hear me, you hear me quite breathy. I feel like I've got a little bit of a stutter breath going.
No,
cool, that's fine, that's just me. That's for you at home as well, if you can hear that. I'm just gonna put that back a little bit. Okay, so thoughts on Jurassic Park. That's Fulton King, sorry. Fulton King asking thoughts on Jurassic Park.
See, I've watched the new ones, but I've never watched the old ones. So I'll give the ones with Chris Pratt were okay. Like, nothing special, nothing memorable, to be honest. Just okay. Just another movie that you put on while you're scrolling through your phone.
Wow. Actually, I don't have any strong feelings either way. I just like dinosaurs. So, yeah.
I can't wait till you get to that question from you, because... You're going to enjoy the story behind this.
I will. That's the tease then. I will hold on to that question for a moment. Looking Sharp added, thoughts on literally any movie made before 2010?
I don't remember any film made before 2000. Do you know what? When was Monsters, Inc. made? Do you know what? I can get it. I've got it. Toy Story, the first one, was a great film. There you go.
That was made before you were born, though.
There we go. There we go then. There we go. Looking Sharp should be happy.
I went to the cinema to see that, and oh my god!
Wow, that's mental.
Didn't need that. Wow, that was a bit of a, that was a very
I'm so
sudden.
Sorry.
Oh, my back! It hurts the thought of that one. That wow. Ruby Roberts asking, why haven't you watched the entire VSQ/ Kevin Smith universe yet?
I just not got around to it yet. I promise I will though.
There's some duds. I'll be honest, there is a couple duds, but you know, generally, Mallrats, Dogma, Chasing Amy, they're all good films. Get on them.
I'll watch them.
Right, so here we go with the stuff from Instagram. Ian Skinner, back again. He asks, murder, frame, or kill? Elizabeth Short, Lee Harvey Oswald, or Marilyn Monroe?
Sorry, can you ask that question again? I didn't really...
Murder, frame, kill. Elizabeth Short, Lee Harvey Oswald, or Marilyn Monroe?
Okay.
We're both Googling Elizabeth Short, are we?
I thought Elizabeth Short was the girl who played... Oh, no, never mind. I'm stupid. I don't want to say that on a podcast.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah.
I was going to say, isn't that the person who played Scarlet Witch in Marvel? But I think I'm wrong.
That's Olsen. It's Elizabeth Olsen.
So I heard one name, which was what, Marilyn Monroe?
Yep.
Or Frame. What were the other two ones?
Elizabeth Short, who is the Black Dahlia murder thing. And Lee Harvey Oswald, of course, who killed
Jake. Okay, we'll go with Kill Lee, and then
Murder Elizabeth.
Yeah, there we go.
There we go. Sorry. Hopefully that'll appease Ian Skinner.
We're gonna get and I made the wrong choices.
We've got Slim's the daddy asking, who is your favorite ref and why is it Ref Graham?
He is a great ref. I would say he's my favorite ref actually. Yeah, I enjoy whenever he's reffing my matches because we can always have a laugh with him. The joke that Fulton has with him is every time he goes into a match, he will try and get him to break. He will try and get Graham to break, like, and laugh. So I think it's funny every time that you just see it and he's like, he's got you.
I think I've got the answer then for Adam's. Damn it. That's how it appears on Instagram as well.
There we go. We've both made the mistake. We're good.
Well, because his Instagram handle's Adam Fulton. What am I going to do with that? So he's also asked, what is Midnight Breakdown? In brackets, he'll get it.
Oh. So Midnight Breakdown is our first ever tag finisher that we realized we couldn't hit on everybody. So we immediately scrapped it. We hit it on one person and they took it so well. And then we tried it on a second person at training and we immediately went, yeah, this isn't going to work. So Midnight Breakdown was the first move that will never be seen again. Maybe. It depends. If we find someone who can like take it well and it looks brutal, we'll do it. But until then, it will never be used again.
So what's the key to that? Is it just someone small and light or?
Like we've got like, it's basically like going for a suplex, like a stalling suplex. They've got to be all the way up like that with a decent jump. And I've also got to like powerbomb them. And I don't like sitting out, so I always go to my knees, so it doesn't look good either. So it's also on me.
Right, I think I can see it mentally. Okay, yeah. So
he does like a half hatch. He does like a half hatch suplex, and then I
power he grabs legs on the way back down.
It's also we searched and we couldn't find anyone who had ever done it.
Mm-hmm.
So we immediately went right. We've got it on like film. Get it on your Twitter so we can say we created it. And to this day, I'm still sure we created a tag move. So if anyone wants to prove me wrong, please find the move. It's on Fulton's Twitter. Go watch it. Go watch the move and then see if you can find someone else do the same move and at me in it, just so I can see.
There you go. There's the challenge. Instagram, I think that's Gaz Williams. He asked a couple, but I think we kind of covered them already. Who inspired you to become a pro wrestler? Obviously, it's Rey Mysterio and Batista, because you're in the ring with him. And what do you like about LND? And you kind of talked about that as well, that it's the creativity and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah, just so. Like, also, I will say another thing that I love about LND is the promos that we make, the stupid ideas that we get for promos. Like, our next promo that we're going to film, I think it's one of the funniest ones we're going to do. I can't wait for it.
I enjoyed it. I mean, I know it's probably absolutely different reference, but I probably haven't seen the film and sounds like you haven't either. But the one that you're beating down, Glasgow Grindhouse. And my brain automatically went to Office Space when they're beating down the printer. So it's probably a much cooler film that it's been referenced to, but in my head I was watching it going, they're beating up the printer in Office Space. That's So speaking of, that's the questions. Oh, no, we've got our questions, of course. I'll just make sure I haven't missed any. Oh, no, we've got the name association. Right, my two questions then. One man fight, two sheep or one cow?
Cow.
Okay.
I'll go for the cow. Oh, well, hang on. You went silent for a second. I got a look there. Hang on. I got a look there. What's that about?
I still believe in the sheep, and I've got video evidence that one sheep could beat one cow.
You sent me that video evidence.
It's pure luck, and people have pointed out it's pure luck, but it happened. We've also got the question that we teased earlier. What's your favorite dinosaur?
Triceratops. And I'll give the story behind this. I knew you were going to ask this question, and I don't know dinosaurs as well, so I was like, I'm looking, and I will say I got told it's not a dinosaur, and it upset me deeply. I wanted to say a dodo bird, and I was told it's not a dinosaur, and that upset me a lot. So then I was like, I'll just pick the flying one. And I was and Fulton was he said the name of it and I completely forgot it. But then he was like, don't say the Pokemon's name version of it. And I was like, stop it, because I will.
Were you thinking, right, Pterodactyl, were you thinking Aerodactyl?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. So, and then I was like, wait, I know the one that I like. What's the one with the three horns called? To which Fulton then shouted at me and went, well, it's got three horns. What do you think it's called? I was like, I don't know. Triceratops. I was like, okay. I was like, that's on me. Fair enough. I was like, that's me being stupid.
So I like Triceratops because I'm old. I remember when it was the Blue Rangers Dinozord.
I wasn't really a Power Rangers kid either. I'm sorry.
Anyone who hasn't watched Power Rangers Once and Always on Netflix, shame on you. Shame on you all.
I'll give it a watch tonight.
It'll mean nothing to you, though.
That's fine. Who cares? You're going to get a message on Twitter being like, what is this?
It's 55 minutes of nostalgia. I was in tears at the end. It was amazing. But it will mean nothing to anyone over the age of, like, 20, probably. The age of 20. Maybe.
I mean, I'm 22, so I should get that, but I just never watched it.
This has been an eye-opening experience for me. anyway, right, okay, so we've got name association. Hopefully none of these names I'll have to cancel, because I know I've got ones I've got to do tomorrow where I can't use. So, name association, we've got Thank You Matthew Podcast Network, being on Scottish Wrestling Network. We'll make this nice and quick. One word answers, hopefully, unless you've got a massive, amazing story about it. Number one, Stephen Flutter.
Great Booker.
Medallion.
Great Bad Guy.
Damon Havoc.
Short Style. There you go.
Ben Vicious.
Oh, that's a name that I've not heard in a while. Good wrestler, hope he's doing well.
Luke Ross.
Super Kick City.
Ivy Mist.
Good wrestler.
Dan Evans.
Really good wrestler. I got to wrestle. There we go. Third time's the charm. I got to wrestle him in Sweden, and I was the eye opener.
Chris Kendall.
What are we on now? Six matches, so seventh match coming soon. There you go. There's my association.
Theodorus.
Really nice guy. He was one of my first outsiders in Target, and he kept me right throughout the entire match. So what a great guy.
Johnny Fear.
I never really got to speak to him, but I'd say great with the crowd. He used to shout at them all the time. He used to scare me when I used to watch him. I was like, he just seems angry.
I will say for future ones, Matthew, if you are listening to these, make it 10. It just makes life easier. We've got
how many is he put? Wait, how many is he put?
There was 18. Freddie Brick.
Great wrestler. It's very unfortunate that he got an injury, but when he comes back, he'll be better than ever.
Soldato.
Brother.
Tommy Oliver.
Great wrestler. I got to watch him develop as a wrestler, and I thought it was really cool. So
the best Power Ranger. Joshua James.
Really nice guy. He let me hit a 450 on him, and that was the first ever time I hit it, I'm pretty sure. So I openly warned him about that, and he was like, I don't care, do it. I'm like, okay.
Wrestlers are just a different breed. They're just willing to go, yeah, land on me, it'll be fine. Scott Oberman.
Also the same match as Dan Evans. Really, he gets very excited when he thinks of cool ideas, and I think it's amazing because it just shows like the passion people have for wrestling.
It's Rory Coyle.
Again, another really nice guy. He was one of the outsiders who came to me and he was like, I've watched some of your stuff, and that was like the first time I've ever heard someone say that to me who was a wrestler. And he was like, yeah, I've watched your stuff, so you hit a 450, and I was like, yeah. I was very taken back by it, the fact that someone else, like another wrestler, had gone and watched my stuff. So, really nice guy, really good wrestler.
17, Krieger.
I'm coming for you, Krieger. I'm coming for you. You don't get like a cool thing. All you get is, I'm coming for you, and I'm just coming for you and looking sharp. There you go.
Final one, looking sharp.
I'm also coming for you. I plan. I can't wait to get my hands on you again. So I will say, really great, great trainer. Honestly,
great trainer. But once the bell rings, you're battering.
Yep. What, you wait till we get in that round.
So I think I've nabbed you for an hour, and like we said at the start, this is amazing. We even got this hour today.
we made it work.
We made no glitches either. The only thing that people may notice on the video, there was a point where I had to look down, is because I flipped the box where I had my wrestling mask in, spilt my drink, and I don't know if anyone can see this on my leg, but
I just see the outline. Yep,
looks like I've pissed my pants. So there we go. Other than that, though, it was fine. So where can people find out more about? So this episode's going out 28th, so it's nice and recent. Where can people find out about Sami Sparx? Where are you next? Plug all your stuff.
28th. Okay, so you can find me on Twitter at Sami Sparx. You can find me. I've just grabbed my phone to check. you can find me on Facebook at Sami Sparx, Instagram Sami Sparx, and I will be. You said 28th.
28th. So next Friday.
I believe I'm at W3L, but we can check that very quickly.
Their Mayday stuff. I don't think they've announced a match for you, but I'm sure it will be by the time this goes out.
Well, if they've not, you can see me on the 29th in Dunblane, the 30th in Dunfermline, and then Mayfest in Gala Shields.
There we go. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for being able to speak to me. I'm glad that we got this done.
I've loved it. Oh, I loved it. I was very nervous coming into it, and I loved having a load of technical problems with a microphone, a headset, but we got there eventually.
We did. I'm just here breaking wrestlers' podcast cherries, and this is a nice successful one. Yep. So
I can't wait to be back on like the 500th episode.
Oh, give it 10 years.